Thank you. Let's get it started. Let's get it started in here. Let's get it started. Hello and welcome to everyone who is here tonight for the book launch party celebrating Helio Fred Garcia's latest book, Words on Fire, The Power of Incendiary Language and How to Confront It. But tonight's not only a celebration of this urgently needed book, it's also a moment for all of us to come together and recognize the work that lies ahead for us all, to push back against and hold accountable those leaders who wield words on fire in order to divide us. Now, for those who don't know me, my name is Katie Garcia. I am a senior associate at Logos Consulting Group. I was the primary researcher for Words on Fire, and I will be your MC for the evening. I'm also, incidentally, Fred's eldest daughter. Here's what you have to look forward to in the hour that we have together. In a few moments, I will pass the proverbial mic to Fred, who will take a few minutes to share his gratitude to some of the many people who made Words on Fire possible. Then I will invite several speakers up who will share their words of encouragement and support. These are people who helped make the publication of Words on Fire possible and who have endorsed the book. They also happen to be just extraordinary human beings. Then we'll have a quick Q&A with Fred, where you will be able to ask questions about Words on Fire. And we will close with a message from Fred, talking about the work that lies ahead for all of us together. Right now, we have, at the current count, 110 people, but we expect another 100 to join from all over the world. We wish we could see all of your faces right now. However, there are several ways that you can participate throughout tonight's event. If you have a question for Fred that you would like asked during the Q&A, feel free to type that question in at the Q&A box, which you'll find at the bottom bar of your Zoom screen. If you would like to send a message of support to Fred, or just connect with us more, you can use the chat function, which you'll also find on the bottom Zoom bar. Two of my Logos colleagues and I will be monitoring the chat throughout the night. And finally, if you would like to post about tonight's event, please do so and tag both Fred and use the hashtag WordsOnFireLaunch. That's hashtag WordsOnFireLaunch, and my colleague Maida has just posted that information into the chat box. Now, without further ado, it is my deep honor and privilege to welcome the man of the hour, Helio Fred Garcia.
Thank you, Katie, and good day, everyone. Thank you for joining our virtual launch party for Words on Fire. I'm Helio Fred Garcia, and I'm speaking to you from Laurels in my home in Santa Fe, New Mexico. I want to begin by expressing my deep gratitude to each of you. We expect more than 200 people on this Zoom from around the world and in many time zones. These include people in Europe, where it's very late at night, and in China, Australia, and Thailand, where it's early Wednesday morning. You are part of this celebration because you have touched my life in some meaningful way. Some of you for decades, some of you only recently. But I know that it takes a village, and I would not have gotten here without all of you. Let me express my gratitude in concentric circles. First and foremost, to my life partner, the love of my life, Laurel Garcia Colvin, and our two daughters, Katie and Juliana, and my two brothers, Tom and Chuck, and their families, and our parents' fourth son, George Hesse Leon, who is attending from his and my hometown of Rio de Janeiro in Brazil, with his wife, Anna, their daughters, Anna Cristina and Cristiani, and their families. I want to thank my colleagues at Logos Consulting Group, Barbara Green, Anthony Ewing, Kristen Johnson Henningsen, Maida College Zhang, Katie Garcia, Holly Hellstrom, Inan Shen, and Raleigh Mayer. And former Logos colleagues who are with us tonight, Laurel Hart, Oksana Trush, Iris Wenting Shui, Evan Flood, and Michelle Ciafaletti. On to the book itself. My deepest pool of gratitude goes to the person who worked the hardest on it, my primary researcher, Katie Garcia. Katie was an integral part of the book throughout. She watched just about every Trump rally, interview, and statement. She read just about every tweet. She read each page of Mein Kampf and scholarship on the Rwanda genocide. And she distilled much of the social science that is quoted in the book. Katie was previously the primary researcher on two of my other books. Thank you, Katie. In all, I estimate that we have about 7,000 pages of research for a 250-page book. There were other researchers who also contributed much. They include Inan Shen and Ife Wu, who is with us tonight from Detroit. The idea for the book began with my book agent, Leah Nathan Spiro. Leah represented me 10 years ago on The Power of Communication, Skills to Build Trust, Inspire Loyalty, and Lead Effectively. And she did more than represent me on Words on Fire. She was a thought partner and a catalyst throughout, and she identified other resources to help me. These include Anne Greenberg, who helped conceive the structure of the book and edited the early drafts of the proposal, and Dee Dee Sluka, who edited much of the manuscript through what is now Chapter 6, and these were the most challenging parts of the book. All of these people worked on the book when it was an idea in process. The book itself is the result of excellent work by the team at Radius Book Group. I send great thanks to the whole Radius team, including Scott Waxman, the publisher, Mark Fretz, the editorial director, and Evan Fail, editorial assistant. The manuscript was edited by Henry Carrigan, who took the draft from 105,000 words to 75,000 words. I have to tell you, I wept for each of my precious words that he mercilessly cut. But the book is so much better because of Henry's editing. I love the book cover. It was designed by Tom Lau, a huge shout out to Tom. And I love the interior design. It was done by a team at Newirth and Associates led by Jeff Farr. I want to thank the endorsers who read the book in manuscript form or in galleys, and who not only endorsed the book, but have been encouraging me and actively promoting the book. These include my friend and the former head of public affairs for the Marine Corps, for the Pentagon, for ISAF in Afghanistan, chair of the Joint Chiefs of Staff, as well as the Department of Homeland Security, Colonel David LePan, United States Marine Corps, retired. My friend, President Emeritus of Interfaith Alliance, the Reverend Dr. C. Welton Gaddy. Welton not only endorsed the book, but he has had me as a guest on his radio program and podcast, State of Belief, three times since I began work on the book. Evan Wolfson, the founder of Freedom to Marry, and the person most responsible for the successful campaign to win marriage equality for same-sex couples in the United States, who has also been working tirelessly in other countries to help secure the freedom to marry in those countries around the world. Evan's work serves as a playbook for others who want to make the world a more just place. My dear friend, mentor, and America's crisis guru, Jim Lukaszewski. Jim's new book with Steve Harrison is The Decency Code, The Leader's Path to Building Integrity and Trust. The Decency Code plots a practical approach to regain civility, integrity, and empathy in our relations with others. It is a must read for leaders, investors, employees, and engaged citizens more generally. Khazir Khan, the Gold Star parent and American immigrant who at the 2016 Democratic National Convention held up a copy of the Constitution and offered candidate Trump the opportunity to read it. Shame he didn't take Khazir up on his offer. Kazir's and Ghazala's son is U.S. Army Captain Humayun Khan. Captain Khan literally put himself between his troops and two suicide bombers in Iraq, giving the last full measure of his devotion to save the men and women in his command. The Khans are Muslim, and candidate and later President Trump bitterly attacked them, attempting to dishonor Humayun's memory, but it didn't work. I am honored that Kazir has chosen to support my book. And Philip Jan Rothstein, who runs a specialty publishing company focusing on crisis. We were introduced only a few months ago when my book was just going to press, so he couldn't get on the back cover, but Phil has been a vocal champion for the book, and we'll be hearing from these folks soon. The book is getting visibility because of the excellent work of David Ratner, Johanna Ramos-Boyer, and Aaron Bolden of David Ratner Publicity and Publishing Consulting. A year ago, as I was writing the book, I was able to test the ideas in the public square with the help of the folks at West End Strategy Team in Washington. These include Matt Dorf, Ari Geller, Elise Morosky, and Josh Glassdetter. And that's the book. Now I want to do a shout out to all of you. Given that at this point there are about 200 of you, I won't be able to name all of you, but let me describe you. This launch is being attended by many current and former students of New York University's School of Professional Studies Public Relations Program. These include Xin Rao, who is in Chengdu, China, Iris Wenting Shui in Shanghai, Cyrillic Mim Ratanawarapos in Bangkok, Thailand, Diana Montoya Maya in Bogota, Colombia, Paolo Pomate in Northern Italy, Vildana Kurtovich and her sister Jana in Vienna, Austria. And among those here in this country is David Siegel, who was my student 30 years ago this September, and Ken Kerrigan, who was my intern 32 years ago, my student in the 1980s and 90s, a client in the 2000s, and is now a beloved member of the NYU Public Relations faculty. And Ken's new book, out in August, is Our Future in Public Relations, A Cautionary Tale in Three Parts. I wonder where Ken learned the rule of threes. And there are also many other current and former professors in the NYU PR program, including Tony Muzzi Falcone, who's participating tonight from Rome, Italy. There's also a large group of current and former students, faculty, and administrators in the Stern School of Business Executive MBA program, and also current and former students, staff, and faculty at Columbia Engineering. And I want to do a special shout out to the Brain Trust at Columbia Engineering's Professional Development and Leadership Program, including Dr. Jenny Mack, Dr. Liz Strauss, and Gabby Lilienthal. Also, current and former students, faculty, and staff of the Wharton Communication Program of the University of Pennsylvania. With us today, there are many current and former clients of my firm, including Rafael, who is in Sao Paulo, Brazil. There are also many who serve or have served in uniform, including in the United States Marine Corps, the United States Navy, the United States Air Force and Space Force, and the United States Army. And also current and former students and uniformed and civilian faculty of the United States Defense Information School. I am humbled and grateful for your service and for your participation tonight. On this Zoom, we have current and former board and staff of Interfaith Alliance. I want to do a special shout out to Rabbi Jack Moline, the president of Interfaith Alliance, who has been extraordinarily supportive to me and who has introduced me to a number of people who made the book better. Also on this call are the current Secretary General and the Secretary General Emeritus of Religions for Peace, along with current and former staff of Religions for Peace. With us tonight is the founder and former board members and staff of Freedom to Marry. There's also many progressive clergy on the call. I want to make a special shout out to the newly minted Reverend Dr. Stephen York in Maine. Stephen will soon be out with a fabulous book about James Baldwin. Also on this call are many Unitarian Universalist clergy and lay leaders, and you'll be hearing from some of these people in a moment. But first, I want to set a context to share some things that many of you probably don't know about me. About 25 years ago, I was in a career turning point, and I was seriously considering going to seminary to become a minister. I was in active discernment for more than a year. In the end, I decided against entering the ministry, but I chose a different way to pursue my calling. Since then, I've been active behind the scenes, helping to equip leaders of faith traditions, of human rights and civil rights organizations, civic leaders and engaged citizens to use their individual and collective strengths to help bend the arc of the universe a bit more towards justice. In particular, as I do with my clients, I help them harness the power of communication effectively, helping them develop a mindset, techniques, and tools to effectively raise a prophetic voice in the public square. And to do more than talk, but to also secure meaningful policy and social outcomes. For 17 of those years, I did it primarily with the Unitarian Universalist clergy and leaders. I served for that time as a public witness advisor to the Unitarian Universalist Association. And in that time, I trained more than 1,000 ministers on public ministry. It was through then UUA President John Burens, who's on this Zoom, and moderator, the late and beloved Denny Davidoff, that I was introduced to Religions for Peace and to Interfaith Alliance. John also introduced me to Evan Wolfson and Freedom to Marry. And John introduced me to the Stark King School for the Ministry, where for 7 years I was on the associate faculty through their Master of Arts in Social Change program. And in that program, every year I taught a 40-hour week-long intensive for mid-career religious leaders called Preaching Beyond the Pulpit, Media Skills in Public Ministry. Many of my students from those courses are on the Zoom tonight. Later, I was invited to join the Stark King Board, where I served for 7 years, including 4 as board chair. All of this work with Unitarian Universalists, with Religions for Peace, with Freedom to Marry, with Interfaith Alliance, was behind the scenes. My role was to empower and equip others to do the hard work of countering oppressions. What I'm most proud of in all of that time, what I'm most proud of in my career, perhaps until this book, is developing the UUA's Standing on the Side of Love campaign, now known as Side with Love. I was asked to do that by then UUA President Bill Sinkford. The Reverend Meg Riley was then the head of public witness for the UUA, and she and I collaborated on the creation and launch of that. Meg Riley will be speaking in a moment, but before I introduce her, I need to acknowledge that I've never been the one out front in the public square. I was always behind the scenes, so Words on Fire is a new experience for me. I'll be the one in the public square trying to raise a prophetic voice of my own. And I'll be relying on all of you and many others to equip me and to keep me focused. With that, it's my honor to invite my dear friend, my student, my client, my collaborator, my colleague of 21 years to please start the discussions. I invite the Reverend Meg Riley. Please unmute your mic and say a few words.
It's not public witness if it's not said in public and there aren't witnesses. With those words, Helio Fred Garcia began decades of coaching Unitarian Universalists to speak out publicly about what matters to us. Churches support what's good will never be a headline, was Fred's sage advice. He taught us how to shape narratives that would present our values compellingly and garner media interest. Fred's wise counsel helped Unitarian Universalists to become a respected public voice about marriage equality, immigration, racial justice, and other issues central to our religious values. He trained, as he said, hundreds and hundreds of clergy to be comfortable in front of cameras and writing op-eds. His design of standing on the side of love is still going strong 11 years later with Side with Love. The tagline is harnessing love's power to stop oppression, exclusion, and violence. And that is exactly what Fred has done with his gifts and talents for decades now, with Unitarian Universalists and with many other individuals, organizations, movements, and campaigns. He has harnessed the power of love to stop oppression, exclusion, and violence. Fred shares in the introduction to Words on Fire the very personal, very painful experiences of those forces of violence and exclusion in his own childhood, and his subsequent commitment to help others who suffer because they are othered, because they are immigrants, gay, lesbian, bisexual, or transgender, because they are Black or Brown, because they are part of minority religion, because they are othered. Fred has worked tirelessly, usually behind the scenes and often pro bono, with grassroots activists and progressive voices in hundreds and hundreds of rooms. He's coached activists about how to think strategically and how to share information in ways that are lively, compelling, and easy to understand. I am thrilled that Fred is making his wisdom more accessible to more people by writing books, such as Words on Fire. Siding with love has never been more important, and he tells us how to do that at a time when brave words and brave acts have never been more urgently needed. Thank you so much, Fred, for your wisdom, your generosity, and your devotion to justice. Helio Fred Garcia, congratulations.
Thanks, Meg. And let me send congratulations to Meg, who this weekend was formally named to be the co-moderator of the Unitarian Universalist Association, making her essentially the co-chair of the board and also assuming other important duties. Congrats, Meg. Katie.
Thank you, Meg, and also congratulations. It is now my honor to welcome to the Zoom stage President of the Interfaith Alliance, Rabbi Jack Moline. Jack, if you could unmute, perfect.
Thank you. This is such an honor for me. I want to tell you that Fred has been generous in sharing the story of how he fell in love with this country. It happened in August of 1974 when he was a congressional page and sat in front of the Capitol on the night that Richard Nixon resigned the presidency, waiting for the tanks to roll in, because that's what he knew about when a government fell. And when it finally occurred to him that that wasn't going to happen, that this republic was going to stand and that it was going to continue to function, he became entirely devoted to it and has spent his life in public service, doing everything that he could to defend his best understanding of the Constitution and the Bill of Rights, which I think ought to be everybody's understanding of the Constitution and the Bill of Rights. He believes, as he's told me, that everything he does is part of his service to his country, especially his devotion to educating people who are serving in the military and the other services. This book emerges from that love. This book emerges from Fred's desperate desire to see the United States not only survive, but to thrive and to live up to the best of what it is meant to be. I serve in the position that I'm in right now as president of Interfaith Alliance, thanks to Fred, because at a time when the organization was in transition, being held together by the devotion of a very few people, it was Fred who had the confidence that I could step in to a position so well filled by the aforementioned Reverend C. Welton Gaddy and bring us back to a place of dominance and predominance in the conversation about the First Amendment. It was that important to him. And the story will likely never be told of exactly how much Fred had to do with keeping this institution going at a low ebb in its existence and in helping us come back to where we are today, where he is privileged to serve as President Emeritus, Chair Emeritus of the Interfaith Alliance Board. The other thing I'll tell you about Fred is that he is a person of integrity and impeccable judgment. You know that when you watch everything that he does, but it makes it very difficult when Fred gives you a compliment to be humble, because he is such a keen observer of the human experience that when he says you're doing something right, he really leaves you no choice but to believe it. The last thing I'll say about Fred is that he has a puckish sense of humor. I mention in parentheses and without illustration, two words, truck nuts, which was something that just tickled us all. But I'll give you this challenge, and I know Fred will appreciate it. I leave it to each of you watching this this Zoom tribute to Fred to wonder exactly what kind of pants he's wearing underneath that vest and tie. Mazel tov, Fred. I am so proud of you, and I am persuaded that this book is going to have an important influence on the future of our country and the rhetoric that preserves it.
Thank you, Jack. I'm now pleased to welcome the editorial director for Radius Book Group, Mark Fritz. Mark, if you could unmute yourself.
Oh, thank you. I consider myself humbled just to be amongst the people speaking this evening. Fred, thanks for the invitation. And nice to meet the rest of you, however, virtually and not in person. I first met Fred when he and his agent, Leia Spiro, came to the Radius Book Group office in New York last fall. That was when people went to office buildings to work, and we met in person and didn't risk anyone's health, or we didn't really think about whether or not it did, and now we know it probably did, but we weren't mindful. Fred had nearly completed Words on Fire by then, and I was able to read most of the book before we met. So I kind of knew what was happening going into this conversation. And in the manuscript, I discovered the connection between the bellicose and fractious language used in public discourse and the frayed social fabric that showed signs of disintegration right in front of our eyes every day. It was as if Fred was some sort of guru explaining the most confounding experience by putting his finger on the essence of the problem. With clear, simple language, he helped make sense of a disturbing reality that had gone unsolved and was mystifying. Thanks to his tedious research, and now I understand his daughter's research too, and his writing, the rest of us can now cut through the fog and frustration surrounding us day after day in civil and political discourse. Watch the news, listen to radio talk shows, read blog posts, scan social media, or just chat with somebody on the street, and we quickly realize that what people say causes a ripple effect in the actions of the world around us. Fred's book gives us both an explanation of this phenomenon, a guidebook for parsing the use of incendiary language in real time, and a means of responding constructively to reclaim social discourse and the society that rests on our ability to talk respectfully with one another. Fred, thank you for sharing your insights and wisdom with the world. Such a refreshing counterweight to the stories recounted in Words on Fire. Blessings.
Thank you, Mark. Now, our next speaker was going to be President Emeritus of the Interfaith Alliance and host of State of Belief, Reverend Dr. C. Welton Gaddy. Unfortunately, he wasn't able to join us at this time today. However, he did email over a statement that I will try to do justice to as I read it aloud. So, from Welton. I met Fred in Jordan and discovered some of his many interests and talents while there. The conversations involving mutual interests continued once we were back in the USA. Thankfully, mutual interest brought us together again in a number of different organizations, and the enjoyment of dialogue together increased. I had the privilege of meeting and getting to know the members of his talented family and interacting with them. Eventually, I had the great pleasure of Fred becoming a respected leader on the board of Interfaith Alliance. Across the years, I've enjoyed reading Fred's published thoughts on a wide spectrum of issues. Of course, I learned from his personal and professional experiences, as well as his scholarly insights. From the time he first told me about the next book he wanted to write, I knew something special was brewing. Fred devoted himself to research, news stories, and troubling developments that inspired him to write a book that could enable people to understand the danger we are facing and understand how to think and behave as a good citizen. The words on fire that now can be read come straight from a person on fire wanting to make a contribution to this country and help erase the flame of hate, lies, and attacks on our democracy. I wish I could be with you tonight. Know that duties in my thoughts are with you celebrating Fred's accomplishment and hoping that the public will learn from and be inspired by his passionate writing. Thank you, Welton. Now, our next speaker for tonight, our next message, comes from Gold Star parent and immigrant American Kazir Khan. Unfortunately, he's also not able to be with us virtually at this time, but he did send along a video message, and it is my deep honor to share that with you.
Brother Garcia, congratulations on the publication of your latest book. It has been an honor to read the early manuscripts of this important work and now see this book released. It will surely become a much needed part of the national conversation. We are living in a time when the pervasive rhetoric of hate seeks to divide our blessed country, a time when national leadership is not only lacking, but causing harm to those who are the subject of incendiary language, a time when solutions are scarce and the people are calling on their leaders to stand up for the values that founded this country, justice, equity, and liberty. Words on Fire serves as a guiding light during this dark moment in our history. 4 years ago, I held up my copy of the Constitution and invited candidate Donald Trump to read it. Today, I hold Words on Fire and urge every American to read this book. If we are to save our democracy. Thank you, and may it be so.
Thank you, Kazir, for your message of support. Now I am honored to welcome to our Zoom stage former Pentagon and DHS spokesperson, Colonel David LaPan, U.S. Marine Corps retired. Colonel LaPan.
Thank you, Katie. Fred, what a great night. And actually, in respect to all the people from all the time zones you mentioned, I'll say good morning, good afternoon, and good evening. I've known Fred for more than a decade. I have always admired and respected him as a teacher, as a communication professional, and most important, as a person. So I was very excited when he came to Washington, D.C. last year to tell me about his latest book project. I was honored and humbled when he asked me to be involved. But then, after explaining the premise of his book and the outline, he asked me to consider writing an endorsement. My first thought was, why me? My second thought was, I better hurry up and agree before the coffee wears off and he rethinks his choice. So I quickly said yes, and I anxiously awaited the arrival of the manuscript so I could first see in writing what Fred had told me about. Of course, I was not disappointed and I knew I wouldn't be. I'd like to refer quickly to a note that I wrote Fred after he sent me his manuscript. I believe you have succeeded in making this book scholarly and approachable, interesting and educational. There are many money quotes throughout this, but this is one that stood out to me. We can learn the lessons of today to prepare for tomorrow, to help civic leaders, engaged citizens, journalists, and public officials recognize the phenomenon and take steps to hold other leaders accountable in the future when they use such language. I would say that Fred has written one of the most important books of our time, not just for what it says, but the time at which it's being published and for the tools he provides to citizens and leaders. But it's not just a book for 2020. The lessons, the examples, the practical tools will be useful to us and those in other countries for years to come. This book has impact. It has been my experience in more than three decades of US military service at home and abroad that those who best understand and appreciate the freedoms and the gifts of our democracy are those who wish they had them, and those who chose to become US citizens, who experienced life in other countries and other systems of governments before they came here. I am an American by birth. Fred, as he writes so movingly in the preface to Words on Fire, is an American by choice. That is a powerful thing, and this is a powerful book. I'm proud to have played a small role in it, but I'm more proud to call Fred a mentor and a friend. So thank you, my friend, my fellow American, and congratulations.
Thank you, Colonel Lepan. Now I am honored to invite our next speaker. He is the founder and former president of Freedom to Marry, Evan Wolfson. Evan?
Thank you, Katie, and congratulations to you for all your work, not surprisingly. I got to know Fred, as he said, when he stepped up to offer his expertise and his counsel and his patience and his skill to Freedom to Marry. He even came on the board and was a resource we could draw on again and again and again. But when he says he usually operates behind the scenes, I have to say that's true, because when he wrote me about this book and asked if I would take a look at the manuscript and give thoughts and now endorse it, and I read his bio and resume as an accompaniment, even knowing how much I had relied on him and how helpful he had been, I had no idea of the breadth of your accomplishments and the number of books you've written and so on. So to have you bring all of that strength and expertise to this important moment and this important work has been, you know, very inspiring to me. At Freedom to Marry, we knew the importance of language, we knew the importance of words, the importance of persuasion. We saw how it could be forces for good, and we saw how they could be used against a group of people and stigmatizing a group of people. And what you've done with this book, Fred, is take something that, you know, I'm sure everyone on this call knows Trump's rhetoric is terrible and he's terrible and it's all awful and so on. But what you've done is so skillfully explained how it is terrible. How does it operate? How is this part of the autocrat's playbook? How does his lone wolf whistles work? How does his fomenting division and cynicism and trashing truth and creating a climate of toxicity and cynicism and despair operate to achieve even worse things? But you didn't stop there. You also have given people, and as somebody who worked together with you to get something done, you've given people a way to turn that into action. So not only is this a highly readable and important way of understanding what's happening, cataloged with Katie's research and so on, but it also is a playbook for our team, for our side, for us to push back, to call out this toxicity, to dispel that cynicism, to hold leaders and politicians and activists accountable and give them the tools to be able to do something to turn this country around, to help us demand that they speak up in constructive ways, to help us, as you say in the last part of the book, be engaged citizens and to believe that we can achieve change. At Freedom to Marry, lesson one was believe you can change things. And you have conveyed that through this book, through the words, but you've taken the words as we work to do and given a way to make them into action. And I really appreciate that. We all need to do everything we can between now and November and beyond to get this country on track. And you have really given us a playbook for doing this.
Thank you so much, Evan. Now, our next message comes from James Lukaszewski, America's Crisis Guru. Now, he is here tonight. Hi, Jim. Welcome. And Jim is here in person, and we also have a recorded message. So to start, I will share Jim's recorded message with all of you.
It's also, hello everyone, I'm delighted to be with you today to celebrate what I think is one of the most important communications books in history in the United States, and of course to congratulate our friend Fred Garcia, the amazing author and American patriot that he is. I think Words on Fire is an important book, truly. I believe that Words on Fire should be mandatory reading and a guidebook for every journalist, business school, religious leader, and elected official. It's also core knowledge for activists, social change agents, and those planning to overthrow dictators and tyrants, okay? I believe that important institutions in American society and culture have the affirmative obligation and responsibility to stand up and speak out against the use and users of dangerous language. And Words on Fire is the script for that speaking out. Like Rules for Radicals, published about 40 years ago, but still vital, this book should become a handbook for personal and cultural movements to detect, expose, alert, and trigger powerful counteraction to confront incendiary language and those who use it whenever and wherever provocative and provocateurs emerge. Over the years, I've learned and practiced hundreds of lessons, and insights from Fred. And I hope this book will draw attention to the help he can provide to our culture, wounded by the intentional incompetence, vilification, and vengeance, which occurs daily from America's current leadership. Deceit, decency, civility, and integrity have many enemies these days, and like so many examples of the past, we seem to be sitting back and letting our culture deteriorate. Fred's approach, in the simplest terms, really demonstrates the myth we all learned when we were children, that while sticks and stones may break our bones, words will never hurt us. And we learned this about, 5 years old. But at 6 years old, we found out it was a lie, right? Because we're going to school. At the end of the day, some kid we didn't even know was humiliating us in front of all of our friends in the schoolyard, right? And, you know, what we learned really that broken bones will heal, yes, but insults, meanness, humiliation, disrespect, and shaming, indecency, and incivility leave bloodless, invisible, and often permanently irreversible and undetectable scars, as Fred would say, on our soul. Fred's first warning message is powerful yet simple. Terminate the senseless supremacist tendencies that, if permitted to continue, will destroy our democracy. It is time to return our culture and our democracy to their fundamental promise, that of liberty, life, and the pursuit of happiness. And Fred, I can hardly wait for that to begin. Thanks again, congratulations, and we look for lots of news about the book in the coming days. Thank you.
So Jim, does that about sum it up? Jim, you're muted.
There we go. Thank you so much, Fred. This is a wonderful event. The reaction to it that people are sharing is really an amazing thing, because you're one amazing guy. Thank you so much. This has really been an amazing event. I appreciate you letting me participate, my friend.
Thank you so much, Jim. So now we are going to turn to the next part of our evening, and that is our Q&A. So if this technology is working correctly, you will see Fred and I on your screen, and I'll ask Fred to unmute himself. You've been sending your questions along throughout the evening. So Fred, the first question for you, why did you decide to write Words on Fire?
One of the things I do in my teaching and that we do at the Logos Institute is study patterns of influence and patterns of persuasion and patterns of audience reaction. And those patterns have explanatory power. They help us understand what happened in the past, but they also have predictive power. They help us predict what's going to happen next. And about 5 years ago, I began to be alarmed by the patterns of speech in the political process. And as the campaign got nearer and nearer, the language got more and more incendiary. And I began to post on social media warnings that if that language were to continue, it would mobilize people to take matters into their own hands, and it would put whole groups of people at risk. I tracked the patterns, and as the run-up to the midterm elections in 2018 happened, as I have a whole chapter on in the book, I worried that the language had gotten so incendiary that what previously had manifested itself as hate crimes was going to lead to mass acts of violence, including terrorism. And sure enough, about 10 days before the election, the Tree of Life Synagogue was attacked by someone using the very language that then President Trump was using as the rationale for the violence. And I began writing Words on Fire the day after the Tree of Life Synagogue shooting. And regrettably, that pattern continued right through El Paso, which I was about finished with the book. I had to add El Paso into one of the chapters because it also justified, the shooter in El Paso justified his mass murder of people using Trump language and Trump frameworks.
Thank you, Fred. I have a question in the chat box from our friend Carmela Glover. What was the most—
Hey, Carmela.
What was the most surprising takeaway from all of the research done for Words on Fire?
The most surprising takeaway was one of the predictions I made in the book seemed to have come true. And that is, because the president was not challenged on the consequence of his language, he kept ratcheting up. And what surprised me was it wasn't until General James Mattis publicly said, "Mr. President, what you're doing is not only unconstitutional, but you have never used language in my presence that unites only to divide." It was that external validation that the pattern had accelerated. So I described the early pattern was indirect. If Obama was not born in the United States, then he cannot be president. Then it moved to Nancy Pelosi supports human trafficking and illegal drugs. Then it moved to go back to where you came from. But after the book was already at the printer, it moved to the only good Democrat is a dead Democrat. When the shooting starts, the looting starts. And then the call to mobilize the active duty military and the Secretary of Defense saying of American cities, we will dominate the battle space. And that was too much for General Mattis. And so I'm pleased that General Mattis gives us a model. So I guess, Carmela, that's the surprise. It took someone like General Mattis to say that's enough. And immediately after that, a bunch of other 3- and 4-star admirals and generals came out and said the same thing. It modeled the behavior that I had written about in the book on how to stand up to this kind of language. And we now have in General Mattis a really good example that we can use.
Thanks, Fred, and thanks, Carmela. We just got several great questions in the chat. So first, from our friend in Brazil, Rafa. Oi, Rafa.
Oi, como vai, Rafa? Tudo bem?
How can the book be used to help people in Brazil who are also experiencing incendiary language from politics?
Thank you, Rafa, for that. And note, I am also a Brazilian citizen. I am a dual citizen of both nations. And I weep for what is happening in Brazil as well. My book is not about any particular country. In fact, the early chapters are about other countries. I give examples of Winston Churchill in World War II as an effective model of communication. I give examples of Germany between the wars as an example of the opposite. I give examples of Rwanda. I was going to add, but I chose not to add a chapter about other parts of the world that have had similar issues. The method, the naming of the pattern, the naming of the consequence of the language, and the language that says this is inappropriate, it is not right, it has dangerous consequence, and you must stop or we will hold you accountable for the consequence, has applicability wherever there are structures of accountability. Now, there are some parts of the world that don't have such structures of accountability, and it would not work there. But wherever there are structures of accountability, where there are civic leaders, where there are civil institutions, where there are journalists who have a relatively free press, this kind of technique is likely to work.
Thanks, Fred. From Denise Mullen.
Hey, Denise.
So many old friends. It's great. What would the ideal outcome of this book being disseminated be?
I think there are three, Denise, three ideal outcomes. The first is a far more aware and literate citizenry that can recognize the patterns early and knows what to do when they see the patterns. The second is, as Jim has said, through journalists, through business schools, through other institutions of education, through other civic institutions, to equip people to be able to actually raise a prophetic voice and say, no, you can't be doing that. And then the third is it will make future leaders think twice before they step over the line. But that won't happen if we don't have the first two. So part of my mission in the book and in this event and in other public speaking that I'm doing, and I hope I can inspire you to do the same, is to spread the word about the phenomenon, the technique, and the ways to hold leaders accountable. That should lessen the magnitude and frequency of other leaders doing what they otherwise would have done.
Thanks, Fred. These are probably going to be our last couple of questions. Do you believe the incendiary language is solely from Trump, or do you believe he's being influenced in some way in the framing of his message that divides our nation? This comes from Valeria.
Hi, Valeria. He is clearly influenced by the world around him, but I don't believe that he's intentionally taking anyone's advice. My own sense, and in the book I quote, it happens to conform with my own sense. In the book, I quote the former head of counterintelligence for the FBI, Frank Figliuzzi, who said, it really doesn't matter whether Trump really is a white nationalist or only plays one on TV, the consequence is the same. One of the things I document in Words on Fire is what I call Trump's dance with white supremacists, his dance with white nationalists. And that is, he signals to them, and they signal back. The Daily Stormer, the neo-Nazi website, actually refers frequently to their relationship with Trump as wink, wink, wink. When Trump said of Charlottesville that there were good people on both sides, David Duke tweeted a thank you note to Donald Trump, and the Daily Stormer put out to its followers, he loves us. He is signaling to us that we are good people. That creates a cycle of he signals to them, they signal back, he signals to them, they signal back. I don't believe that his tweeting of the video of a guy screaming white power to a Black Lives Matter activist was accidental. It is part of the pattern. It is part of the signal to white supremacists. And then he takes it down. And they got the signal. He takes it down. They applaud that the signal was there in the first place. I think it's that cycle that is influencing him. Again, not necessarily because he shares those views, but because he finds it instrumental in helping him accumulate power and keep people off balance, at least so far. But I think General Mattis really is a turning point in getting people to stop taking him as seriously as they did before. I think also the story about Russia putting a bounty on fatalities of American and allied troops in combat is going to also peel away a lot of his support. So if anything, he is off balance now, and there is leverage to begin to influence him in a different way. Okay.
So unfortunately, this has to be our last question. For those whose questions I have not gotten to, I will work to type some answers into the chat, and my colleagues will help with this. So one question, it's a similar question that's coming from a few different people, from Sunny and Lance Colvin in particular.
Hi, Sunny. Hi, Lance.
So the question is, and I'm putting both together. What was the saddest, most heart-wrenching thing that you came across in your research? And on the opposite side, what was the most hopeful or encouraging thing that you learned in writing this book?
Let me start with the most hopeful. In the book, I profile three leaders who went too far, who use language in ways that caused people's lives to be lost, or who risked people's lives being lost. And what gives me hope is that when those leaders were called on their language and the consequence of their language, they stepped back, they stopped doing it. In two cases, they went out of their way to make sure that they remedied the harm that they caused. They couldn't remedy it for the people who'd already died, but they worked really hard to prevent others from using that same kind of language. That's what gives me hope. And I use that as the transitional chapter to what we can do about it. The thing that most discouraged me was the recognition that dehumanizing and demonizing is so prevalent, that it is part of the human condition. And we need to recognize that leaders can appeal to the better angels of our nature and make us better. They can also appeal to the worst demons within us. That is part of the human condition. That's why leadership is so important, why inspired and benevolent leaders are so important, because malign and malicious leaders can have such a negative effect on individuals and societies as a whole.
Thank you, Fred, and thank you everyone who submitted a question. I'm typing away trying to answer those, and my colleagues will help me behind the scenes. So now I turn to you, Fred, for your closing message before we end tonight.
Thank you, and those who have questions you'd like to ask me privately, feel free to reach out to me privately, either through email or through social media, direct messaging, things like that. So let me thank all of you for being here today. And before we adjourn, a number of you have asked me over the last few weeks what you can do to help. And I thought about that question a lot, and I've decided to make an audacious request. I'll start small and then work my way up to the really audacious part of my request. So what can you do to help? Well, first, get the book. Read the book. If you're so moved, take a selfie reading the book and post it on social media. And remember to tag me. If you're further moved, write an Amazon review. We fear that those who object to the book will try to sabotage the reviews, so the more we have, the more we'll be able to withstand the assault. Share word of the book with your networks, both social and human, and invite me to speak to your groups, your associations, your colleagues, your companies, your commands, and your congregations. That's the easy part. Now comes the hard stuff. This is about much more than any one author or any one book. What I hope we can do together is to convert the ideas in the book into a movement, to align with and to fortify existing movements. A movement to stand up to bullies, a movement to restore civility in civic life, a movement to restore honor to public life. Now, some might argue that we aren't big enough, that only 200 people can't make that big a difference. But my students and my clients on this Zoom know that one of the patterns I study is disproportionality of impact, how small changes can have a very big effect. And I'm confident that we can make a difference. In the immortal words of the anthropologist Margaret Mead, never doubt that a small group of thoughtful, committed citizens can change the world. Indeed, it's the only thing that ever has. So yes, we happy few, can change the world. And we've heard today already from people who are already changing the world. Dave LePan is changing the world through his work on bipartisan policy and holding toxic leaders accountable in senior public life. Evan Wolfson continues to change the world by advocating for the freedom to marry in countries around the world. Welton Gaddy is changing the world in many ways, including through his bully pulpit on State of Belief. Khazir Khan is changing the world in his public speaking and his work with Joe Biden. Jack Moline is changing the world through his extraordinary leadership of Interfaith Alliance. Jim Lukaszewski is changing the world through his decency initiative. And Meg Riley is changing the world through her leadership in the Unitarian Universalist Association. But there's so many other people on this Zoom who are also changing the world. Professor Aza Karam is changing the world through her leadership as Secretary General of Religions for Peace, the largest multi-religious organization in the world that harnesses the moral authority of religious community to resolve conflict, promote sustainable development, and protect the earth. Dr. William Vengley, Secretary General Emeritus of Religions for Peace, continues to change the world through his work as an advisor on world religions at the Fetzer Institute, whose mission is to harness courageous compassion and bold love, powerful forces for good in the face of fear, anger, division, and despair. And my friends Donna Ritchie and Phil Shirley in Jackson, Mississippi are changing the world. They work for Godwin PR, working throughout Mississippi and the South. They led a business coalition in an effort that succeeded 48 hours ago to get the state legislature to finally move to remove the Confederate battle flag image from the Mississippi state flag. And about 60 minutes before we came on this Zoom, the governor of Mississippi signed that bill. We are changing the world. And on this Zoom call, we have dozens of clergy, professors, leaders of business and communication and other professions. We have journalists and writers and editors and publishers and TV hosts and radio hosts and bloggers and students, all of whom can change the world. My book closes by quoting President Obama. The most important title in a democracy is not president or prime minister, it is citizen. And we citizens can change the world. So here's my big ask. Model the behavior we wish to see. Reward the behavior we wish to see. Hold leaders accountable for their destructive behaviors. The arc of the universe is long, but it bends towards justice, and together we can help bend that arc more. So here's how to do that. Side with hope over fear. Side with civility over incivility. Side with decency over indecency. Side with inclusion over exclusion. Side with science over ignorance. Side with competence over incompetence. Side with caring over indifference. Side with connection over destruction. Side with humility over arrogance. Side with taking a knee over using a knee on others. Side with unity over division. Side with kindness over insult. Side with peace over violence. Side with justice over injustice. Side with love over hate. And encourage all of your networks to do the same, just as I'm doing right now with mine. It is zero dark 30 in America, but after the dark night of civic despair, there can be a new dawn. In the last few weeks, I've seen a shift, and we can accelerate that shift. Thank you all for being here. Thank you for being you. Thank you for being present as I start my new part of my journey. Thank you especially to those who spoke. Thank you, Katie, for producing and moderating this launch. Thank you, Maida and Inan, for helping run the event. And thank you all for your love and support. Please be in touch with me and with each other. Now back to Katie.
Thank you, Fred, and congratulations on this remarkable work. And thank all of you for being here tonight. It's been incredible to watch the chat and all of the messages of support and to look at so many amazing questions that were asked through the Q&A. We hope to keep engaging with you and answering those questions in the days and weeks to come. There is a link that is being posted in the chat right now by my colleague, Maida Zhang, for where you can buy your copy if you don't already have one for Words on Fire. I also want to invite those two colleagues, Maida and Inan, who have been working behind the scenes tirelessly for the past hour, making sure that technologies worked. There is Maida, and there is Inan, who hopefully you can see. And that is a wrap, folks. I hope that you leave tonight or today, depending on the time zone that you are in, feeling inspired to take up this call that Fred has just given you and that we need to live out in the world. So once again, thank you and have a wonderful evening or day, depending on your time zone. Farewell.
Thank you, everybody.